Hey everyone, and welcome to the very first Retrovember. Retrovember is a month I wanted to dedicate to retro gaming. What do I mean by retro exactly? The general consensus I found on the internet is that retro is defined around console generations 5 and 6, and earlier. So this means anything up to GameCube, PS2, and the original Xbox is considered retro. Now, why did I explain everything that makes a system retro? Well, I figured that would be helpful since not every topic in this mini-series is going to be about the NES or SNES in particular. But rather, I'll be jumping around different points in time in, you know, the retro stretch of time, if that makes sense. While arcade machines aren't technically on home consoles, they are still part of retro gaming as a whole, which is why I decided to make a video on them. Now that we got that out of the way, let's talk about arcades. Ever since the first arcade machine was manufactured in 1929 with Majestic Moving Target by Gottlieb, arcades have become a global phenomenon. Every time I walked into my local arcade, I felt like I was in paradise. All these retro games in one big building just waiting to be played. Seldom did I ever have the opportunity to go to an actual arcade, but when I did, it was an event. Don't get me wrong, arcades still exist in the form of Dave & Buster's among other franchises. However, they're not really the arcades I was accustomed to growing up. Nowadays, they're just child casinos where kids beg for their parents' credit card to play iPhone games on a big machine. I know, I sound like a boomer. It's kinda true. My favorite arcade was undoubtedly Pinball Wizard. By far one of the most famous arcades in the US, Pinball Wizard didn't mess around with variety. Of course, you had pinball machines since they were part of the namesake, but there were so many retro machines as well. You had your essentials like Pac-Man and Space Invaders, but you also had other games like Dragon's Lair 2 and Qbert Cubes, which was apparently a rare machine, and it's even rarer to see both Qbert Cubes and the original Qbert under the same roof. Even rarer was the Atari game Arabian. It's no secret machines have evolved, so games are more interactive than ever. Gone are the days of a joystick and a button being on every machine. Often I see newer arcades offer more interactive experiences, like the racing games with built-in steering wheels and pedals, and Pinball Wizard was no different, as it too housed these racing simulators. Despite all these amazing machines being in one place, Pinball Wizard closed its doors 3.5 years ago. Meanwhile in Japan, arcades are still massively popular, with the most well-known being Sega's Akihabara-based buildings. With how big arcades are in Japan, one must wonder, why aren't they as huge in America? Actually, why aren't they as huge in any other part of the world for that matter? I was talking to some friends from the UK, and they also have said that arcades are few and far between across the lake.
What many people will tell you is that modern gaming put arcades out of business. The downfall of arcades can mostly be attributed to the fact that anyone can download and or emulate arcade games from their own home, thus defeating the purpose of going out to a separate building just to play arcade games. That being said, I feel like this isn't the entire reason. I think the business models that arcades followed made it hard to make a profit, thus resulting in the ability to afford maintenance, rent, electricity, and paying employee wages. Later in the video, I'll show you my draft of what I think a successful arcade can look like, both in terms of variety of arcade machines, as well as a sustainable business model. Even though arcades are fading away, doesn't mean we can't look back on them. Let's browse some arcade machines, shall we?
First machine I remember seeing a lot was this Neo Geo cabinet. Back in the day, I had never heard of the Neo Geo system. In fact, the only exposure I've had to this line of products was actually Terry Bogard's inclusion in Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, as his first appearance in a game was on the Neo Geo system. Developed by SNK, this housed Art of Fighting, Samurai Showdown, Bust-A-Move, which is known as Puzzle Bobble in other regions, and King of the Monsters. It's no secret that SNK made a lot of fighting games during the Neo Geo days, so this probably explains why 3 out of the 4 games in this cabinet are of the fighting genre.
Although, it is strange that King of Fighters was nowhere to be seen on this cabinet, as King of Fighters was arguably one of SNK's most popular series. Next, we have the Nintendo Super System, an arcade based on the Super Nintendo Entertainment System. This machine was made to hold multiple games at once, including F-Zero, Contra 3, and Super Mario World of all things. I remember seeing this and being shocked that one of the best 2D Mario games could be played in an arcade. The controllers on this machine were interesting design-wise. Of course, you had your typical SNES controller layout, but this machine's controllers have more of a boat shape. Unlike the SNES, the Super System gave you a time limit on the included games, so you couldn't exactly go through 8 worlds and beat Bowser at the local arcade. Well, I guess you could in theory, but at that point you'd be turning your mortgage into quarters. Now, most of these machines were just American reboots. There weren't too many machines that went above and beyond here in the US. If we want to see how far arcades have truly come, we need to take a look at Japan's arcades in Akihabara. One machine that really took my interest was this Gundam Battle Pod. This offers quite an immersive experience, as the machine has you sitting in a chair facing towards a 180-degree display, making you feel like you're really there in the center of the action. When you make your way into the pilot's seat, you're able to make use of the two joysticks on either side of you to truly feel like you're piloting a Gundam. On top of the controls and the visuals, the chair even vibrates with explosions, so this machine basically gives you the closest thing to a true Gundam experience. Now, I'm not familiar with the Gundam franchise personally, but I understand it's massively popular. In fact, it's the 16th highest grossing media franchise of all time, just barely behind Dragon Ball. As if the visual experience wasn't enough to sell you on this machine, it also gives you your own pilot's card, so now you're a certified Gundam pilot. Please, ladies, one at a time. This pilot's card is more than just a souvenir from your Japan trip, though. It actually tracks your performance should you ever return to your battle pod. This card-based progress-saving functionality turned out to actually be pretty common when I was researching for this video. In fact, there was an F-Zero machine that accepted GameCube memory cards. One last machine I want to talk about is the Transformers Human Alliance Sphere, which can only be found at Sega's Joypolis Arcade. Yes, you heard me right, an arcade machine that places a person inside a sphere that moves around. I was only able to find footage of the outside of the machine, but I'd imagine that on the inside, it's one of the most immersive experiences out there for arcades. Now that we've seen both where arcades came from and what they are now, I want to give an idea of what arcades could become. A pitch, if you will. So I think what's important to have is a healthy balance of retro games and modern interactive experiences. As such, I'm gonna have this arcade split into a retro half and a modern half, mainly to show the past and present of arcade gaming, almost like an arcade timeline in one building. On the very left, we're gonna have the essentials, where arcade gaming truly hit a crescendo. And I'm talking about the classics, Pac-Man, Galaga, Space Invaders, and throwing in a few lesser-known machines like Q-Bert and Dig Dug. Maybe even throw in some rare ones like Exterminator and Atari Tank. These will go in what I call the Classics Row. Across from there, we'll have some games that are a bit less old but still pretty retro. This is where I'd put games like that Neo Geo cabinet from earlier in the video, the Nintendo Super System, and other similar cabinets. I do want to have as much variety as I can, even though a lot of the fighting game cabinets fall into this category of games. Perhaps one half of this row can be fighting game cabinets like Neo Geo and Street Fighter, while the other half is other cabinets from around that era? We'll label it the fighting slash console ports row, as pretty much all these games were eventually ported to home console platforms. As for the rest of the retro space, I want to make some of it pinball machines, since those were just as popular as the arcade machines. I mean, come on, who doesn't love a round of pinball every once in a while? As for the rest of the space, I'll probably include arcade machines that don't use traditional controls. Something like Crisis Zone, or maybe go bigger and include more recent machines like Taiko no Tatsujin that use a unique drum-based control scheme. Definitely gonna throw in the Luigi's Mansion arcade game, as not only does it use a unique controller in the form of a Poltergust, I just genuinely enjoyed this arcade game in general. When I saw that machine at my local arcade, I made sure to always play it at least once. Now, onto the modern area. This is where the crazy stuff happens. I will say this before going into it. I don't know how importing works for arcade machines. Between the costs and, you know, localization, because I'm assuming these machines would be in Japanese language instead of English. If that's even a thing with arcade machines. So, take this idea with a grain of salt. Maybe we can get these machines in the US, maybe we can't. This is purely just for imagination's sake. Okay, so if we want to demonstrate the sheer limits of immersive arcade experiences, we should definitely throw in either a couple Gundam pods or something technologically similar. I mean, think about it. An arcade machine that's both fully immersive in visuals and haptic feedback that also saves your progress via a cool-looking card? How would that not be popular? This next one doesn't necessarily have the haptic feedback that the Gundam Pod has. However, I think this still draws the player in with its unique controls and multi-monitor display. The machine I'm talking about is called Densha de Go, a train simulator. This game makes use of a unique control scheme meant to be similar to that found in Japan's metro system. Plus, this goes to show that not every arcade game has to be super intense and have high-octane action. Alright, I didn't want to repeat machines that were already mentioned in this video, but the Transformers spherical machines from the Joypolis arcade would be a perfect fit here. Need I say more? I think it's safe to say this would provide anyone a crazy unique experience. Seriously, how often do you get to say you adventured with robotic transforming vehicles while sitting in a spinning orb? Now that we have a bare-bones floor plan here, how would we run this arcade? Would we stick to the token-based business plan where people pay a certain amount for tokens that go in the machines? Would we have people use quarters like the old days? Perhaps adopt the modern game concept of loading your money onto a reusable card? Well, none of the above, actually. You see, a trend I noticed with all the arcades I've been to is that people don't want to constantly reload their prepaid cards or constantly have a bucket of quarters with them. That's why I've drafted a business model that lets you play all the games you want without having to drag spare change everywhere, nor do you have to reload a card with money. Okay, so constantly going to the change machine to turn dollars into quarters is time consuming. Us lazy gamers want to move as infrequently as possible. So what if you paid for time in the arcade? Instead of spending money on the individual machines, you pay for a certain number of hours where you have access to all the games. This way, the arcades can make plenty more money instead of just buckets of quarters. Imagine all the tax paperwork involved with buckets of quarters. Yikes. Now, what would the rates be? I'm no financial expert, so take these numbers with a grain of salt, as all this is purely hypothetical. For an hour's worth of arcade time, I'd say the $5 to $10 range. So if little Timmy wanted to play Mortal Kombat and rip heads off from opening to closing, which we're assuming would be 9 a.m. to 5 p.m, that'd be anywhere from $40 to $80 in a day from one person. Little Timmy better hope he gets enough allowance for a day like that. Now, we could stop there. However, we want to incentivize people staying for longer. Let's assume the hourly price is $8 per hour of arcade access. In this case, we'd offer 3 hours of arcade access for $20, as it'd be cheaper than just paying $8 three separate times. Maybe later down the road, we'd do something similar for 5 or 6 hours of arcade access. That would depend on how many customers arrive monthly, and how long on average customers stay in the arcade.
So we've got our floor plan and business model for our hypothetical arcade, which features retro classics, as well as some more advanced machinery to make the overall experience something to remember. Remember, this idea isn't perfect. I'm sure there's a couple factors that I'm missing that goes into running an arcade, but I think if someone were to take this idea and run with it, it could maybe bring arcades back? Maybe? I don't know about you, but there's just something to be said about playing something like Pac-Man on the original hardware. It feels more authentic since that's where it came from. Sure, you can find Pac-Man on some website or even emulate it. I mean, heck,
Google Maps had a thing where the entire world was a Pac-Man map. But I firmly believe nothing compares to the original experience of a retro game to play an old game on old hardware. That's why arcades were so cool to me. Since I didn't grow up in the 80s, I never got to experience this nostalgia firsthand. Walking into an arcade almost felt like walking into an 80s pocket dimension. And it was great. I hope we see arcades come back soon. Thanks for watching my video on arcades. This is something I've wanted to talk about for a while, but I finally had an excuse to make this video. I hope you'll tune into the rest of this Retrovember series, because there's more aspects of gaming I want to talk about. If you like the Retrovember video so far, let me know with the hashtag Retrovember on Twitter, maybe Instagram. I'll be checking all social media. Maybe if enough people like it, I can make it an annual thing, like Peanut Butter Gamer Zelda Month. Who knows where this will go? Anyways, I encourage you to subscribe so you don't miss the rest of this mini-series. Follow me on Twitch as well if you want to chat about arcades and other things gaming with me live. I'll see you in the next one.